Good morning, welcome to Merland Rise Church. Today Jim's going to be preaching to us from Genesis 28, looking at the people who came after Abraham, at Isaac, Rebekah, Jacob and Esau, and looking at how Jesus can use their mistakes to teach us some lessons for today.
We've been following the story of Abraham in the last few weeks, and I'm going to just move on from Abraham and read to you a passage from Genesis chapter 28 about the lives of those who came after him. So this is a sequel to what we've been hearing about the life of Abraham. Genesis 28, starting at verse 1. So Isaac called for Jacob and blessed him and commanded him, "Do not marry a Canaanite woman. Go at once to Paddan Aram, to the house of your mother's father, Bethuel, and take a wife for yourself there from among the daughters of Laban, your mother's brother. And may God Almighty bless you and make you fruitful and increase your numbers until you become a community of peoples. May he give you and your descendants the blessing given to Abraham, so that you may take possession of the land where you now live as an alien, the land God gave to Abraham." And then Isaac sent Jacob on his way, and he went to Paddan Aram to Laban, son of Bethuel the Aramean, the brother of Rebekah, who was the mother of Jacob and Esau. Moving on to verse 10. Jacob left Beersheba and set out for Haran. And when he reached a certain place, he stopped for the night because the sun had set. Taking one of the stones there, he put it under his head and lay down to sleep. He had a dream in which he saw a stairway resting on the earth with its top reaching to heaven, and the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And there above it stood the Lord, and he said, "I am the Lord, the God of your father Abraham and the God of Isaac, and I will give you and your descendants the land on which you're lying. Your descendants will be like the dust of the earth. You'll spread out to the west and to the east, to the north and the south. All peoples on earth will be blessed through you and your offspring. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go, and I'll bring you back to this land. I will not leave you until I've done what I promised you." Verse 20. Then Jacob made a vow, saying, "If God will be with me and will watch over me on this journey I'm taking, and will give me food to eat and clothes to wear, so that I return safely to my father's house, then the Lord will be my God. And this stone that I've set up as a pillar will be God's house, and of all that you give me, I will give you a tenth." So, as we said, we've been tracing the footsteps of Abraham in recent weeks. Abraham, of course, known as the father of Israel, the father of faith, and the patriarch of the patriarchs. And this whole story, if you remember, began with God's life-changing call on Abraham to up sticks and go to the land I will show you. And with that command came this mighty promise that you've heard echoed in this reading, that Abraham will father a nation and be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. And then, of course, there is the long and famous faith-stretching wait for the birth of a child who will be the key to that promise. It can't happen without him. Until finally prayers are heard, the promise is kept, and Isaac, the miracle child, is born. And so, of course, now Isaac has been born, it's all plain sailing from here on in, isn't it? Well, not exactly. Next, of course, after a bit of family feud as well, comes God's baffling call to sacrifice the very child of promise. And high drama on Mount Moriah, as at the last second, a lamb takes the place of Isaac on the altar. And so God tells his people very graphically that child sacrifice, which is practiced by some of the peoples around them, is not what the living God requires. He's saying, "I don't want you to do that." And in telling them that, he also points to the very opposite truth, that it is he, the heavenly Father, who will give his Son, the Lamb of God, to take our place and to pay the price of our sin. It's a picture and a prophecy that's so clear, you can't miss it. So Isaac, the promise bearer, survives. And much later, as Abraham senses his end is near, you may remember this from a couple of weeks ago, he sends his servant back to Haran, back to Mesopotamia, where the story began, to get a wife for Isaac. Isaac's just been told to do the same thing for his son. And to get a wife for Isaac so that Isaac too can pass on the promise. And he returns with the lovely, gentle, caring Rebecca, who captures Isaac's heart. And then there's another faith-testing wait until she too is with child. And not one child, but two. There are twins. So now, after years of waiting and praying, after family feud and death-defying drama on the mountaintop, all is set fair for the promise to bear fruit. Nothing could possibly go wrong. Or could it? Because this is quite a family. You see, this story is not an idyllic pastoral tale. This is a bit more like EastEnders Old Testament style. You know, Middle-Eastenders, if you want. Do you ever feel that your life can be a bit of a mess at times, that you always envy these people who are really together, but somehow you can't quite nail all of life down, you can't quite get yourself organised, you can't quite get on top of it all? Do you ever feel that? Because I do sometimes. Do you ever feel that you as a Christian, you can't quite manage to be the person that you've always wanted to be and we would love to be, because so often you just seem to mess up and fail? Well, if you've ever felt at all like that, this story is for you, because this lot are a real mess. Yes, they are the promise bearers, but we're going to see what God can do with messed up people. So if sometimes you think that your Christian life or your life in general is a bit messed up, well, this is for you. We're about to find out what God can do with messed up people. Just a quick aside, some commentators and theologians, more liberal ones that I don't personally agree with, have suggested that these stories were kind of made up during the time when Israel was in Babylon to give the people of Israel a bit more self-confidence, to give them a backstory, a founding story, a birthing story. But I think if you're going to argue that, you've got to ask yourself this question. If you were looking to give your nation a birthing story, to give it heft and strength and confidence and integrity, would you pick this lot? Would you write a story about these people? Because that's not going to give you much confidence at all. And to me, that's what tells me that the Bible has the ring of truth, because you couldn't make this up. You wouldn't make this up. And I'm sure they didn't make this up. So back to the story. Now, of course, Isaac and Rebecca have twins. But these boys are not twins. Born of the same mother at the same moment. Twins they are, but because one necessarily sees daylight a few seconds before the other, his brother emerging behind him, clutching his heel, twins they will not be. Because in the custom of the time, the firstborn, even if it's only by the blink of an eye, is going to get the blessings, going to get the inheritance and the preferment. He's going to outrank his brother. And as we read that, we think in the words of the song, there may be trouble ahead. And excuse me, I do have a bit of a cough. As the boys grow up, they develop into two very different characters. They're chalk and cheese. There's Esau, the firstborn, the he-man hunter, the warrior, the man's man, dad's favourite, first on the list for going to that field in Swindon for CVM. You know, this is the man's man. And Jacob, fractionally the younger, who prefers to stay at home, where he's mummy's darling. Where he's a wonderful cook, and his apparently his ragout chasseur aux lentilles rouges was apparently irresistible. So much so that for just one plate of this divine stuff, Esau, back from the hunt, is prepared to barter his birthright, those rights as a firstborn son. and the deal is done. And now there really is trouble ahead. But this is just a preamble to the real sting, because that was a deal. They agreed to it, both of them. Now comes the steal. Father Isaac is nearing his end, and the time comes to confer his blessing on Esau. Mum gets wind of what's going on. This, of course, is the beautiful, lovely, caring, gentle Rebecca, remember? She gets wind of what's going on and hatches a devious plan to have the blessing delivered to her favourite Jacob instead. And Jacob, suitably disguised, impersonates his brother. Isaac seems to smell a rat, but his eyesight's failing. He overcomes his doubts. He pronounces the blessing. Esau then comes back, but it's too late. The words once spoken can't be unspoken. And the prophecy, which was spoken to Rebekah at the birth of these two boys, has come true. The older will serve the younger. And now it's happened. But now, of course, pandemonium breaks loose, because the family's in uproar. A dying Isaac is inconsolable. His love for Esau and his disbelief at the betrayal of his final wishes by his nearest and dearest, bringing a bitter taste to those final days. Esau has now been twice outwitted by his brother, and he's breathing threats of murder. Rebekah is about to lose a husband, and now she'll lose her favourite son, because Jacob needs to get out of there quickly. And it's at this point of family breakdown that we join the story. There was indeed trouble ahead. But I've always found this story rather hard to swallow. We were talking about justice just now, weren't we? How come Rebekah and Jacob are allowed to get away with this blatant deception, these barefaced lies and daylight robbery? How can that be justice? All the more because on the strength of all this, Jacob is going to be the father of a nation. His sons, the 12 ancestors of the 12 tribes of Israel. So how on earth, in the domain of a loving and just God, can that be all right? Well, it's not quite all right. And they don't get away with it. Just think for a moment. With a husband nearing his end, never more does Rebekah, the author of this cunning plan, need the comfort and support of her two sons. And she's thrown it all away. She's lost the trust of one, and she's lost the companionship of the other. Esau won't trust her, and Jacob has to move. He has to go. "I'll send you word," she says to Jacob. "I'll give you the wink when it's safe to come back." Her parting words to him. But entwined as he will shortly be in the nefarious schemes of Rebekah's brother Laban, it's quite a family this, Jacob is not going to be back anytime soon. In fact, probably when she waves him goodbye, she never saw him after that again. So Rebekah didn't get away with it. She suffered the consequences ever after. And with his brother now brooding over plans for his no doubt gruesome demise, Jacob is now a man on the run for his life. He's gained a blessing, but he's lost a family. He's been hoisted with his own petar, and no one gets away with anything. But right at the beginning of the chapter we just read, almost as Jacob is packing his bags, we have Isaac's parting words to his son. He pronounces a blessing on him. Now, hang on a moment, you think. He's just had the blessing, hasn't he? Didn't he steal the blessing? Isn't that the point? Isn't that the cause of all this? So actually, there are two blessings. The first, the one that Jacob stole, went like this. "May God give you heaven's dew, earth's riches, abundant grain and wine. May nations serve you, peoples bow down to you, and may you be lord over your brothers." In other words, that's a blessing of earthly wealth and earthly power, meant for Esau, but unwittingly given to Jacob, stolen by Jacob. Now, the second blessing, the one that Isaac gives to Jacob before he leaves, is a different one. It goes like this. "May God Almighty make you fruitful, increase your numbers, make you the father of peoples. May he give you the blessing of Abraham, so that you will possess the land you now live in. This is the Abraham blessing. It's about people and descendants, and it's about land. That's meant for Jacob, and it's knowingly given by Isaac to Jacob. Now, if I've got this right, because it's a complex story, this blessing, the one that Jacob was always meant to have, is exactly the kind of stuff that that birthright was about, and that's what Esau despised and threw away for a plate of food, because however divine it might have been, at the end of the day, it was still a plate of soup, wasn't it? He's the warrior. He should have been the first blessing, the wealth and the power, and it seems he has little time for all this airy-fairy stuff about being the heir of the promise. That is for Jacob. He wants it. He negotiated for it. He set a price on it. He values it. And he will indeed inherit that promise, the promise to Abraham, that his descendants will be like the stars in the sky and the sand on the seashore. That will pass via Jacob. And in his family, it will start to be realized. And the right blessing has gone to the right man. So Jacob, now a fugitive, without a family, but with two blessings, one his own and one stolen, departs. And later, much later, he's going to give the stolen one back. Years will go by first until, now the head of a large family, that was his blessing, he will finally face his brother again. And now he returns the blessing of power and wealth that he stole. He bows and scrapes before Esau seven times over, and therefore he surrenders the power. He bows to his brother. And he hands over enough livestock to feed a huge army. That's the wealth. And that's handy, actually, because Esau's got one of those. He's got a huge army. And so Jacob gives the wealth back as well. And at the end of the day, the right blessings end up with the right people. So as this story develops, it's not quite the moral quagmire that it appears at first sight. There is rightness in here, and there is justice in here. And the murky waters have cleared. But what is it then that transforms Jacob from the self-seeking thief to the generous giver? Well, of course, being cynical, you might say, well, fear, basically. The day of reckoning, Esau's mighty army, and you may have a point. But it's not just that. Something seems to have changed in the character of this man. Because he gives openly, he gives freely, he gives more than Esau actually wants. So what's happened to him? And now as we pick up the story again, we're going to find out, because something really has happened. He's met someone. We join Jacob on his journey to hang out with Uncle Laban in what in the text is called Paddan Aram, Mesopotamia. Although this, of course, is going to involve rather more hanging out than he probably imagines, if you know the story, because Laban is going to entwine him in his nefarious schemes. So Jacob's going from Beersheba to Haran. How far do you reckon that is? A few days' walk, perhaps. You know, if you walked it, left here at the end of the service and walked north, how far would you have to go to do Jacob's walk? Would it take you, for example, beyond the M25 to the north? It would. Would it get you to the Midlands? It would. It wouldn't get you to Scotland, would it? But it would. It would almost get you to John O'Groats. It's about 650 miles. It's a huge distance. And remember, too, that Jacob dwells in tents. He's a kitchen man. He's not the outdoorsy type. That would be a job for Esau. He's way out of his comfort zone. And on top of that, he's lost his home, he's lost his family, and his life is hanging by a thread. In his dreams, he probably sees Esau leaping out from the next bush, armed with a large hatchet. And so, as a few days in, he lays down for the night in inhospitable territory out in the open with just a stone for a pillow. How do you think he's feeling? He's not in a good place. And dream, he certainly does. But he doesn't dream about Esau and lethal weapons. He dreams about a ladder stretching from earth to heaven with angels going up and down on it. Now, perhaps like me, you've known this story since you were in Sunday school. But how do you imagine it? You see, I've always pictured a kind of divine heavenly hardware store and a giant stepladder. But actually, the text we read calls it a stairway, and many other texts do too. Now, 4,000 years ago, they didn't have DIY stores. The whole of life was kind of DIY, really. Ladders weren't all that common, but they did build stairways. You know, think of those pictures that you've probably seen of those ziggurats, those stepped temple towers, characteristic of the major cities of ancient Mesopotamia. Now, Jacob's family has its origins in Mesopotamia. It came from that culture. Grandma and granddad were born there in Ur of the Chaldees. Mum hailed from Haran, and that's where Jacob is on his way back. So I don't know what Jacob saw. I didn't dream his dream. Whether it's a ladder or a stairway, it's the same message. But it seems to me a stairway brings it home particularly well. Because what the dream is actually saying is there's a highway to heaven. A highway to heaven. And it's a two-way highway. One actual translation calls it a raised highway. So there is free traffic on this highway. There's open communication between earth and heaven. The travellers on the highway are angels, they're God's messengers. So in other words, what it's saying is God speaks. He's not a distant creator who's finished the job and got bored and wandered off. God is involved in our lives. God cares about his creatures. God cares about human beings. God cares about Jacob. And God cares about you and I. Life is not just about the here and now, about what I can see and hear and touch, but life is about a relationship with this wonderful God. And what does this say to Jacob? Jacob, you're on your own. You're far from home. You're afraid. Life as you know it has fallen to bits. The future's uncertain. But Jacob, you are not alone. I will watch over you, says God. I will keep you. I care about you. What a picture. And it's the very voice of God himself that confirms it. And what he confirms is the very promise once again given to Abraham, that actually Jacob will have descendants like the dust of the earth, and speaks the very words that we have just thought about. I am with you and will watch over you wherever you go. I am with you and I'll watch over you wherever you go. This is the nature of God. It's actually in his name. Centuries later, when Moses asks the name of God, the answer he gets is, I am. And that means, I am with you. I will be with you. I'll be there when you need me. When Jesus comes, what's his name? It's Emmanuel, God with us. And what are Jesus' parting words? I will be with you always, to the very end of the age. Echoing almost these words to Jacob. What's Paul's conclusion after all those epistles which we read? Nothing can separate us from the love of God. In other words, this is the God of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Friends, this is our God. This is what he's like. This is his character. Notice too that this dream, this revelation, comes to Jacob. Not when he's in those tents and surrounded by his family, and he's comfortably secure. It comes when he's in a bad place and a dark corner and on a dangerous road, when he's lost and lonely and uncertain and afraid. Are you in a hard place this morning or on a difficult path? Are you unsure of the future of what tomorrow might hold? It is God's name. It is his nature. It's his character to be with his people in their hour of need. And his words to Jacob are his words to you and I. I will be with you wherever you go. I will watch over you and I will not leave you. Notice too that you don't have to be squeaky clean to receive the promise and to hear the call of God and to feel the presence of God. Jacob certainly not. His predicament is a morass of his own making, a rather mean piece of deception and dishonesty. Remember Romans 5 and verse 8 says to us, God shows his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. When we were still less than perfect, as we still are, when we were still flawed and still struggling with our nagging faults, God had mercy upon us. Remember, sometimes we sing that song, I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene and wonder how he could love me, a sinner, condemned, unclean. I sometimes think that. But the wonder is that he does. This promise comes through the grace of God and the love of God because of who he is and what he's like. It's not something that you or I can earn. Believe the promise. Put your trust in God and accept the invitation to walk with God. Put your hand in God's hand and he will never leave you nor forsake you. As we ponder this, I just need to say something about an Essex girl from Harlow. How does she fit into this? Well, Sarah Flower Adams, born in 1805, amongst other things, broke the ladies' record for climbing up Ben Lomond in Scotland. You didn't know that even existed, did you? But she did. But when she wasn't racing up Scottish mountains and catching bullets in between her teeth, she wrote as well, and she wrote about this story. She wrote these words, though like the wanderer, sun gone down, darkness be over me, my rest a stone. A clear reference to Jacob's story and to his predicament here. And what she wrote goes on. You might know it, you might need to be of a certain age, yet in my dreams I'd be, anyone know? Nearer my God to thee, nearer my God to thee, nearer to thee. Now, because that hymn was played by a very brave band on the Titanic as it started to sink, it's become associated with that event and rather with funerals. But it wasn't written for that. It was written to go with this precise chapter. She wrote it before a sermon which her pastor was due to preach the following Sunday. Her sister wrote the music. And I think that Sarah Adams got it right. She understood the dream. Jacob was nearer to God. And importantly, God was nearer to him than he had ever guessed. You and I are nearer to God, and God is nearer to us than we will ever imagine. This is the God who loves you more than you will ever know, who loved Jacob more than he ever guessed. Walk with him, and he will walk with you. Now, as we come to a close, understandably, all this doesn't leave Jacob cold. I hope it doesn't leave you cold either. It does indeed draw him nearer to God. He makes that decision to walk with God like never before. It's a kind of Old Testament Damascus Road experience. So, is that therefore job done with Jacob? Is he spiritually sorted? You know, bish, bash, bosh, and he's done. Cross the line, he's done. Does he now become a faultless paragon of virtue and perfection personified? We often seem to expect that of vital characters, don't we? You know, confronted, converted, complete. But the Bible is much more realistic. Jacob will be changed. He's going to be a new man, but he's not going to be a perfect man. He will still tell a few porcupines, albeit under the severest of provocation. His treatment of his wives will not perhaps be as even-handed as it might be, and I think I'm probably putting that lightly. And the stories of his parenting, oh my goodness, the stories of his parenting will raise Christian eyebrows down the centuries. Now, should that surprise us? You see, have you met with God? And have you experienced in some way the touch of God's hand on your life? I'm sure that if I asked you that question, many of you, all of you perhaps, would say yes. So are you perfect then? You the finished article? Am I? The truth is that you and I, like Jacob, are work in progress. We're on a journey. So, for example, was Paul. Paul, a wonderful Christian witness with a lifetime of self-sacrifice. When I compare myself to Paul, I feel like I'm an absolute midget. But even he says, not that I have reached the goal, I'm still running the race. We're all work in progress. Sometimes I think God might be saying to me, Jim, that's rather a lot of work and not too much progress, but we're all work in progress. We're God's work, and that matters. You know, I've come to think over time that it really is important that as Christians, we ask God to deepen and to build and broaden out our Christian character as the years go by. even if I frustrate him daily. Being a Christian doesn't suddenly make you perfect, but will you and I ask God to make us more like him, to make us holier and kinder and more generous in all sorts of ways and more gracious towards others as time goes by? I think it's important that we do that, even if we so often fall along the way. And finally, another illusion we often harbour, and which the Bible definitely doesn't. Walking with God doesn't necessarily mean that life is a stroll along a smooth path. There will be many bumps and twists and turns ahead for Jacob. There may be trouble ahead, but now he won't be facing the music alone. Some of life's twists and turns can be really terrifying. I think, if I'm honest, that we all in the back of our minds live in some fear of those twists and turns. And Jacob faces them quite young. Family, friends, future, life itself is all on the line. And the moral of this ancient story is that there is an everlasting God whose nature, whose character, whose personality it is to be there with his people and with his friends, to come alongside them and be with them and comfort them and carry them when they most need him. I'll be there. It's in his name. It's who he is. Will you and I put our hands in the hand of God and walk with him? It's his character and nature to walk with us. Amen. Just going to pray briefly as we finish. I'm awfully sorry about the stuffy nose and the coughing. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this story which tells us that it is in your nature to work with faulty and flawed people. And we bring ourselves before you now as we are, with all of our shortcomings and our faults. And we ask that in your wonderful grace and mercy, you will walk with us and we will desire to walk with you. And you will steadily make us more and more like you, so that when others see us, they might see something of you shining out. We ask it in your lovely name. Amen.
I hope you enjoyed that sermon. As usual, during August, a lot of church events stop, although our cafe is carrying on with some special kids events that you can book for. So do go to the website, merlinrisechurch.org.uk, to see what's happening this summer. Also, the elders will be producing some devotionals that will be posted on this YouTube channel twice a week during August, so do subscribe so you get notified of those. Have a great week, and we will see you next weekend.